Thank you. Good afternoon, all. Thanking you all for actively participating for this particular webinar. It gives me, we will be in this duration of 1 hour carrying out a small overview of coating thickness measurement and the methods and applications in auto paint and other industries. So this will give you a broad outlook as to what all products that Fisher can support you. And also we will be taking you through the various techniques of measurement and the principles that is behind these measurement techniques. So a small overview of the agenda that we will be pursuing. So this is basically important parameters of surface finish. Then we will go through coating thickness, the principles like magnetic induction, eddy current, beta backscatter. Similarly, we will also touch on topics like EDXRF, coulometric method, nano indentation, why it is important, what is the basic use, where the application for nano indentation comes into picture. Even industrial applications, we will also show you the various industrial applications we are supporting right now. And we will give you a small brief of what Fisher is and how we can support you in India. So now coming to the main point as to why painting and electroplating are important. So as you all are from the industry, you are aware that how important paint, powder coating or anodizing plays a part in your final finish of the product. It also, painting is one of the main aspects of corrosion protection. So if you need to achieve good corrosion protection, then paint becomes one of your most important application. Similarly, now coming to the electroplating, electroplating is also one form of corrosion protection, but other than that, it also has some functional properties, or these electroplating processes actually helps in improving your functional properties of the items. So you can see there are different types of coatings which are getting applied and different electroplating processes which are there. So some of the functional coatings, like you have gold, silver, palladium, etc., which is quite expensive. And now the measurement of these coatings or these electroplated components becomes very important to ensure that your final product or the final finished item is of good quality. So why is coating thickness important? Why do you need to do coating thickness? So this is one of your major aspects as far as the surface finish is concerned. It also ensures that the effectiveness and longevity of your coatings. And other than that, one important aspect is it, depending on the thickness of the coating or the amount of coating which is applied, it is crucial for your product's final use as well as cost. So depending on how much coating is applied, you can also evaluate as to how much might be the final cost of your product. Even it can give you a parameter of how much savings you can do by reducing the giveaways by applying these coatings. Now, when it comes to Helmut Fisher, how do we support you with our measurement techniques? So we have, if you look at this particular grid, you can see that we have majorly five methods of thickness measurement. So the first one is basically portable DFT meters. These are the normal DFT meters which are used extensively in all industries for paint thickness measurement, or DFTs as you call it. There are different principles. So we will give you a small overview of each of these principles and how it will help you. Similarly, the next one is EDXRF. And there is something which EDXRF is for your electroplated components. This is a completely non-destructive test, and it helps you in determining multi-layer plating thickness. Plus, you can also do material composition analysis as well as plating analysis with these techniques. Then there is coulometric method. This is again a form of coating thickness measurement itself, basically for auto industry or say hard coatings or say decorative finish items. So here, this being a destructive method, People use this to find the multi-layer nickel platings, which they do in the decorative coating system. Then we also carry out, so the first three were basically the coating thickness techniques. Now comes the material testing methods. So we also provide some instruments for material testing. This is basically like ferrite content measurement, electrical conductivity, and circuit profile testing. So we will also give you a small overview of this. The last but not the least is basically nano indentation technique. So this we will give you as to how it helps you in determining the hardness properties of your plating itself and why it is important. Coming to the DFT, this is our overall range of DFT instruments. Many of you must have already been using this, or if so I will just run through the different techniques. So basically, what does it consist of? You have a display display unit, and there is a probe. Now, when it comes to the probe, how does it measure? So basically, there is the probe with convert your actual measurements into voltages. Now, the distance of your probe from the actual metallic object will affect the voltage. So if your voltage is high, that means your thickness is very low. That is because you are very close to the metallic object. Now, as the voltage keeps on reducing, your thickness goes on increasing. So this is the basic principle of how a probe functions. So now coming to the principles as such. So we have first the magnetic induction method. This is as per standards of ISO 2178 ASTM 7091. So in this, the primary requirement is basically your substrate or the base material needs to be a magnetic substance. So say, be it ferrous or say any nickel based alloy, it has to be magnetic in nature. Now, what coatings on this can be measured and how is it being measured? So there is basically a magnetic coil which is there, which actually generates a magnetic flux onto your substrate. Now, as the coating or non-magnetic coating is applied on this, you will see with the principle of probe that I had explained earlier, as the thickness of the probe of the coating increases, your voltage starts dropping. So that is then converted into your resultant thickness value. Now, in this, what type of coatings can be measured? You can basically measure any kind of iso coating or paint coating, or any non-magnetic coating. If the coating is conductive, you can still measure using the magnetic induction method. The only issue with this particular technique is you can measure only a single layer coating. You cannot measure multi-layer. Even in case of paints, if there are multi-layer paints, it will just give you the total thickness of the paint. It will not give you the individual thickness of the paint. Coming to the next method, which is basically the eddy current method. This is again as per standard ISO standard 2360 or ASTM 7091. In this, you are basically measuring the coatings on a conductive surface, but a non-magnetic surface. So your base material needs to be conductive, but it need not be magnetic. So the examples are like you have aluminium or you have copper. So these are the main substrates on which the coatings can be measured. So in this, you're basically inducing an eddy current through your substrate. Now, as the coating increases, you can see that you will see that as the coating thickness increases, your voltage starts dropping and you will be able to transfer this into your micron thickness. Now, coming to what coatings are measured in this. So as I said, the substrate needs to be conductive. The coatings can be only non-conductive. So you cannot have a measurement of zinc on aluminium because this is not what this principle supports. So basically you can either measure aluminium anodizing or you can measure paint on aluminium or paint on copper. So this is the main application using the eddy current method. Now, these two are basically one of the important techniques which are widely used in the market as of date because many of the applications get covered using this. However, there are some certain applications which are tricky. Like, for example, you do a nickel coating on ferrous, example. Now, if you want to do a nickel coating on ferrous, the only technique which is possible is basically a EDXRF or a destructive test. But in Fisher, what we have done is we have developed something which is called as phase sensitive eddy current method. This is as per ISO 21968. Now, what is phase sensitive eddy current? You are basically in this principle, what we do is we in the probe itself, we define the phase angles of your base material, which is ferrous, and we also have the phase angles recorded for elements like nickel or zinc or copper, for example. I'm just giving you an example. There can be other elements also which can be added. So what happens is the phase angle for each of these elements are different. Now, depending on the coating thickness, you can say that there is a voltage, again, similar to the basic principle, there will be a voltage change which happens. So now if you have a phase angle, means now when you do a nickel coating on ferrous, using this principle, you can actually measure the coating thickness directly. You don't need to have a destructive or a XRF instrument. You can directly do it with a probe system. There are many applications which we are currently doing for basically for the two-wheeler segment where there is a requirement for nickel on ferrous coating. So you can, some of you people are already using this. Whereas if there are someone who is interested in some technology like this, do let us know. Even in this particular principle, curvature or roughness of the probe is not that much a problem, because here we are directly measuring as per the phase angle. So it does not depend if your surface is highly rough or if your samples are little small or something like that. So this is a big advantage in a phase sensitive eddy current method. We also can use this for thermally sprayed coatings or TSAs, which are generally used where there are thermal barriers which are coated, which are highly rough and highly thick. The only drawback in this particular technology is basically you need to have some calibration standards. Since we are suppliers of EDXRF machine, we can also support you in developing these standards in our Pune works if required. Or we also ask customers to develop their own standards which can be used for calibration. That is the only drawback in a phase sensitive eddy current method. So what are the instruments which you see normally in the market from Fisher? So these, you can see here directly, there are DFTs or the dual scope MPORs which are there. Then there is something called as phase sensitive eddy current I was explaining you earlier. In this, there is also something which is called as a duplex phase and PMP-10 duplex instrument. Now, what does PMP-10 duplex do? You can see here, basically there is, if you have in automotive segment, what we have seen is there are normally galvanized sheets on which painting is done. Now, some people have asked us saying that we need to measure the paint thickness, but we also need to understand how much is the zinc plating or the galvanized zinc which is applied on the metal sheets. So this instrument actually using the phase sensitive eddy current actually helps you in identifying or measuring the zinc layer as well as the paint layer simultaneously. So this is the biggest advantage for this particular instrument. Now, for the corrosion market, especially in the corrosion industry, we have recently launched three particular models. So this is, one is basically a DFT instrument. The earlier model was basically a dual scope MPOR. Now, with the MMS inspection DFT meters, you can actually, the MPORs will slowly be obsolete. Coming to the MMS inspection, we also have, since its intended use is basically the corrosion market, we also developed along with this a surface profile meter, which is as per the ASTM standards of 4417. And we also have a DPM meter, which is to measure the humidity and the moisture content of the area on which the painting has to be done. So this can be individually ordered, or you can also order it as a kit. We have a provision of doing both. So apart from all these instruments what we have talked right now, the basic advantage or the main advantage of using Helmut Fischer instruments are basically the probes which we supply. So it is widely seen that any application that is there in the market, you have a probe which can support this. I mean, Fischer has a probe to support those applications. So you can have, say, a FKP-10, which is to measure thick coatings, for instance, of, say, around 7 mm or 5 mm coatings on steel or ferrous bars. Then there is a FD-10, which is FTD 3.3 probe, which is for measuring anodizing thickness. And this is with an advantage of curvature compensation. So if you're measuring on surfaces which are curved, normally if you see with the eddy current probe, you have issues as far as measurement is concerned because of the curvature. You need to actually calibrate on such curved surfaces. But with the FTD 3.3, it does a curvature compensation and you can measure it easily. Similarly, for rough surfaces, we have double tip probes. For bends or pipes, we have something which is like a long probe which can be used to measure inside pipes. Then there is something which is called a cavity probe, which helps you in measuring areas which are not reachable, or say a cavity in a car body, for instance. Generally, there is a rule that you have to have a cross section of a car body to find the coating thickness inside. But with this cavity probe, you can actually easily measure inside a car body without having an actual cross section. Then there is something, we have also developed some special probes basically for thick coatings. So these are for aerospace industries where they have very thermal insulation coatings which are as high as 10 mm or 15 mm or sometimes even going up to 50 mm. So we have probes which are basically defined to meet these requirements as well. So anyone who has such requirements are free to contact us and we will help you with more details for such probes. Then there are some special probes. So you can see here, as I said, for measuring nickel or copper. So this was a special application which we have been supporting. So these probes basically support that. For the PCB industries or the electronic industries, we have something to measure the coating thickness, the copper thickness inside through holes. So we also have something which is called as a spacer set. This actually helps you to measure and on different thickness of boards. So the spacer actually ensures that the measurement is always carried out at the center of the board rather than at any other point, because the copper thickness at the center of the board is of great importance for any application. We also have a similar application to check the copper thickness inside PC through holes for a single board dimension, that is a 1.6 mm standard board. So that also is available with us. We also work on something which is called as to measure the surface copper of PCBs. So this is to measure the copper thickness on PC boards. This, we have two probes, basically a ERCU-D10 or a ERCU-N. So this people from the PCB industries can clearly understand this particular application, and it is of great importance for them. There are some special probes for measuring at high temperatures, or say angle probes, or say you also have something which is like for very small areas, we have some special probes which are there. Similarly, as I had earlier defined, for rough surfaces, all these probes can be used for means, especially the ESD20ZN is basically used for casted metal coatings. That means zinc plating on casted material, so which the surface is quite rough, and this will actually help you in measuring that. So Fischer has a probe for any coating application, irrespective of surface roughness or geometry, if it is within its application principle. So this is one thumb rule that Fischer follows as far as the probes are concerned. So what are the advantages basically of these handled instruments? These, the main advantage is it is basically a non-destructive method. It has relatively low cost, easy to operate, accurate and repeatable. This is one of the main strengths of Fisher instruments. Our repeatability and accuracy are much better than is of high regards as far as the market is concerned or the industry is concerned. So this is one of our key strengths. Instantaneous digital display. So we have a direct digital display, which, so different instruments, as I mentioned earlier, have different types of displays. So a basic instrument just gives you a measurement value, but if you go for the high-end instruments, you also get statistical values in that. The only limitation that we have is, since it's a magnetic induction or eddy current principle instrument, the thickness range or the accuracy of the thickness range is thicknesses that can be measured is about 2.5 microns only. We don't recommend these type of instruments to be used for measuring lower thicknesses. It cannot differentiate multiple thickness layers, as I explained earlier, because the principle does not allow to do it, except for the duplex coatings where you want to measure paint on zinc on a ferrous substrate. Coming to some common applications, we have already gone through this, so you can just have a look. And using these DFTs, also single layer zinc, chrome, and cadmium platings can be measured. So these instruments can be used not only for paint, but also for some metallic coatings, but single layer. We have another product, which is basically a beta backscatter method. This is generally used for the busbar industries or the electronic industries, where thick gold plating or say tin plating on say copper, or say you have silver plating on aluminium. So this is one of the basic instrument which is used. The only thing is it involves an isotope. So what it does, it has, is basically there is a Grigor-Muller counter in this, and there is this isotope which keeps on sending signals to your coated surfaces. Now, once it hits the surface, there are lots of count rates which are captured by the Grigor-Muller counter, and based on the calibration that has been done or the thicknesses which has been defined in the application, it converts it into the resultant coating thickness value. So this has a wide use in the busbar industries, as I mentioned, but it can also be used for PCB applications where gold thickness is more than say 15 microns, because this is the only method which can help you in measuring gold thicknesses which are above say 12 to 15 microns. With this measurement method, the magnetic and electrical properties do not interfere with the measurement. So this is irrespective of whether the surface is magnetic or non-magnetic. Now coming to the next main application for handled instruments, which is basically material testing applications. So in this, we have two major instruments, which is basically the Sigma Scope, which helps in measuring the electrical conductivity of conductive surfaces or substances like aluminium or say copper. The wide usage of this particular instrument is for the aerospace industry or say busbar industries, where they need to know the electrical conductivity of aluminium and copper which are being used. So this does what it helps you in determining is it not only measures the electrical conductivity, but it also tells you about its composition, microstructure, and other mechanical properties. So the Sigma Scope actually helps you in not only the conductivity measurement, but other aspects as well. Similarly, you have the ferrite scope. So this is basically to measure the ferrite content in austenitic or duplex steels, highly used for lubricant industries where they have a lot of welding activities done. So this actually helps you in determining the welding properties or how good the weld is. So the ferrite content, and the best advantage using the ferrite scope is it's basically a patented technology that we have, wherein we can directly display the percentage of errors to the customer. So this, they don't have to do any further calculation or interpret the value in ferrite numbers and then convert it into ferrite percentage, because our instrument already does that. It also helps you, in addition to determine the delta ferrite, also strain induced martensite, all these parameters can be measured using a ferrite scope. The advantage why these both these products are highly successful for us is basically because of the calibration standards that we use for the calibration of these instruments. So if you go for the Sigma scope, we have a 14 set standard with us, which actually acts as a master to calibrate the instrument, which is also as per Boeing requirements as well. So we are already meeting that, and we have these standards which helps in calibrating the instrument. Similarly, if you go for the ferrite content, we have a calibration set which actually covers the entire range of the ferrite content measurement which is required. So, and Fisher having its own laboratory or calibration laboratory in Germany helps in preparing these standards in-house and calibrating them. And customers are also availing this facility to get the standards calibrated at these facilities as well. So as I was telling, Fisher has its own calibration facility or the calibration foil manufacturing facility in certification facility in Germany. So we are providing these certificates for you according to DIN 55350-18. A broad assortment of calibration foils is available with us. So we have, for all your DFT meters, we are capable of providing you with calibration foils which can cover the entire range, starting from, say, around 3.5 to 4.5 micron to up to even 1,200 to 1,500 micron. We also have some specially created calibration references for higher thickness as well, for probes which we supply to for aerospace industries for thick coating, say up to 25 mm as well. On request, Fisher can also certify customer foils. So in case if anyone wants to get their own foils calibrated or certified, we can support you with that. And all our calibration processes are as per our laboratories are as per ISO 17025. So this is in short about the calibrations that we do. So what we covered till now was basic handled or handled instruments. Now we come to the important aspects of measurement, coating thickness measurement and material analysis for electroplated components. So EDXRF is one of the technology which actually helps you in doing these measurements at very quick time without using conventional method of cross-section or destructive testing. So this is the major advantage with EDXRF. So how does this principle basically work? So you can see each electron as its own electrolink structure. So in this, what we do is an XRF basically targets the innermost shell of, or the K shell, what we call. And an electron is basically, because of the force at which the X-ray hits this particular shell, electron is ejected from this. When this electron is ejected, it creates a valency over here. Now this valency is basically replenished from an element from the L shell. Now when this electron jumps, what it does is it generates a energy line, which is called as the K alpha energy line. Now this K alpha line, basically the K alpha line is then detected by the detector, and this is then converted into the information that is required to be displayed to the customer. It can be either in form of percentage in ppm or it can be in microns for coating thickness measurement. So the XRF basically works on tin ISO 3497 and ASTM B568. So these are the two international norms which guide the XRF usage. Now, what are the different parts that are involved in a X-ray fluorescence method? So you have basically initially a X-ray tube. So this is nothing but the source of the X-ray. This can be in the form of a tungsten tube or a chrome tube, depending on what the application is. And as Fisher, we can actually help you with selecting the tube. So generally, if you see all the instruments in the market, more or less use the tungsten tube. The next one, after the X-ray tube, comes the shutter. So once the X-ray is energized, it starts coming out. The shutter actually acts as a block or a window which allows the X-ray to come out or stops the X-ray from coming out. So this is the role of the shutter. There are some primary filters which are there. So the primary filters actually help in suppressing the undesired portion of the radiation and thus permit an optimization of the sample excitation. So the primary filters, this can be nickel or aluminium or mylar foil, it depends. So each of our instrument has a set of filters. So depending on which instrument is being used, the filters get automatically selected, or it also depends on the application for which the instrument needs to be used for. Then there is a camera which actually helps you in seeing the object which needs to be measured. Basically, not the object, but the area of measurement. That is, which area or which point has to be measured. This is This is being viewed using this particular camera. Then comes the collimator. So the collimator is nothing but the focus area. So say for instance you are using a connector, now you want to measure at a particular spot, or say for instance you are using any particular sample. Guides the X-ray onto that particular point. So this is the guiding force, you can say. Then you have the detector. So once the X-ray hits the sample, there are energy which is released as per the principle. And this energy released is being detected by the detector. The detector is the main detector, along with the DPP, is the main unit which actually helps in the measurement and conversion of this data, energy data, into the subsequent values that is displayed using the WinFTM software. WinFTM software is nothing but what is the GUI that you see where all your values are populated. And finally, you have, last but not least, the sample placement area where you can actually place the sample physically. Now, as I said, detector is one of your most important aspect for your measurements to be done. So there are three types of detectors. The first one is basically the proportional counter detector. So these are basically used for your coatings, like general coatings like zinc nickel, or say coatings which are not very very thin in nature. So even gold and silver can be measured, but at least you need to have a minimum coating thickness of 50 nanometers and above for using a proportional counter to use this. The count rates in these proportional counter instruments are basically up to 10,000 counts. It has a large window, so typical used to routine measurements of known coating systems and alloys. So you can also do, say for instance, if you are doing zinc nickel, you can also measure the thickness, plus you can also know the composition of your zinc and nickel alloy. But these detectors are not ideal for ROS application, that is ROS screening, or NIP coating thickness with analysis, especially on aluminium. NIP on ferrous, you can to a certain extent use a proportional counter, but the ideal one will be a silicon drift detector, which I come to the next.
So here you have the SI pin or the SDD. SI pin is a silicon pin diode detector. It has a count rate of 1 watt with a small entry window. Energy resolution is, say, somewhere around 180 electron volt. So this actually is, if you see here, I have shown you a spectrum image over here. So you can see each element has a distinct line which can be seen. So the silicon pin diode actually helps you get a clear spectrum of each element which is there in your coating or your sample. This can be used for thin films as well. The silicon pin diode in our case we generally use for applications of hard coatings like titanium nitrate or say gold on titanium nitrate, such kind of applications, and some PCB applications. But the widely used detector at the moment is basically the silicon drift detector. So here you can see the count rate increases up to 5 lakhs. So this has quite, this is a very strong detector which helps you with energy resolution which is as slow as 140 electron volt. So this helps your detection much higher. So lower the energy resolution, higher is the detector detection limits. So the silicon drift detector is widely used for nickel electroless nickel analysis or gold and silver analysis or trace analysis with ROHS and very thin coatings, even in nanometers up to say 5 to 10 nanometers or even lesser at times. So what are the parameters basically which influence these measurements? So as I said, measuring distance is one of the important parameters. But the advantage with Fisher instruments is basically we have something which is called as autocorrection, which helps in compensating if there is a minor change in the measuring distance. So this is basically the distance of the sample from your detector, for instance. So in our case, we generally keep this measuring distance fixed, but if there is a small change, we can do that. We also have a patented technology wherein we can use a measuring distance up to 80 mm. So if you have a sample which is big and which needs, you want to measure it at a depth of say 80 mm, our instrument can help you in doing that as well. Coming to the collimators, we have instruments with collimators as low as say around 20 microns or even lower at say 5 microns. And it goes up to say 1 to 3 mm. So we have different collimator sizes based on customer applications. Our sales engineers will be in a position to let you know which collimator will be optimum or best suited for your application. So this is the size of that. And we have instruments with single collimator as well as 4 collimators as well, multi-collimeters. So as per application requirements or industrial requirements or the industry requirements, we can select the instrument which will be ideally suited for this. Similarly, the measuring time. Now, measuring time is basically, it is very important because it also helps you in determining what is the repeatability and precision. So if it is very thin coatings and critical coatings, then we say a measurement time has to be somewhere around 30 seconds. But in case if your measurement, if you're measuring say zinc or zinc nickel application, you can measure at zinc, for example, zinc on ferrous, which is a normal application or a simple application, you can measure at say 5 to 10 seconds as well. But in case if you're measuring say NIP, for instance, nickel electroless nickel, which is quite a complex coating, and if analysis is involved, then you need to measure at least for 180 seconds because the detector needs that much counts to decipher the measurement and give you an accurate value. Sample positioning. This is another important aspect which depends on the accuracy. So if you have a sample and if the orientation is not correct, then you can have differences in the measured value. So sample orientation depends on the positioning of the detector. So where the detector is positioned, you need to position the sample based on that. Another thing is, if you want to measure the say the detectors must have an unobstructed view. So that means, let us take an example where you want to measure inside a depth of say 5 mm, and if you are measuring at the edges, then it might be difficult because the angle might not, the detector might not have a view of the counts or the energy lines which are coming to it, because it gets absorbed by the edges itself. But if you measure at the center, then there is a high possibility that you can measure without any flaw. So it is very important that how you position your samples to be measured, and this will be guided by engineers at the time of installation. So this will we know that it might be tricky at times, so we will definitely help you and support you in doing this. Now, coming to, as we said, traceability of results and calibration standards, we have again a lab, a certified lab in Germany, which actually helps you in getting these calibration standards. And we have standards for almost all different types of coatings. So any special coatings you have, we already have a standard with us available. So if, depending on what applications you let us know, we will tell you what kind of standards might be required for that, and we can provide you with a certified sample for that. Fisher has been admitted and accredited by DKD Calibration Laboratories for the measured mass per unit area according to DIN EN ISO IEC 17025. So all the accreditations are available, and as I mentioned, we also follow the ISO 17025, which helps you, it helps us in certifying these standards as well. So now, what is the basic advantages? As I said, you have a fast and non-destructive coating thickness measurement in this particular case. We also have this instrument used for trace analysis for ROS applications. You can do micro analysis of complex structures with the EDXRF. You don't need to go for a SEM or something like that, or a destructive test or a cross section for analysis of this, because this is quite fast. It's since the precision and the trueness of these values are quite good, you can rely on these values. Another major advantage using EDXRF is you can also do solution bath analysis. So you have a solution bath which are normally done by AA method or something like that, which takes you close to 2 hours, 2.5 hours or something for getting a report. But using a solution bath analysis with an EDXRF, the advantage is you can do the same test within 30 seconds. Only requirement that we have is we need to have some standard solutions which the customer needs to provide to us, so that we can calibrate the instrument and which can be used as a reference to check whether the instrument is showing the right value. So there are many people who are utilizing this particular benefit because it saves them a lot of time, and it can also be used for retrieving the metal from a bath as well. It is inexpensive. EDXRF method is also inexpensive because there are not many consumables which are involved in this. And the major advantage with EDXRF in our case is we use something which is called as a fundamental parameter method. So this actually helps you in measuring even in standard-free mode. And you can always see that our standard-free values are as close to the actual values itself even after calibration. So this is a biggest advantage of EDXRF method. So some of the widely used instruments from our side in the market, which you can see is basically the XDL series for simple applications. I've just mentioned the applications as well, which are below. So like zinc, nickel, tin, chrome, nickel, geomet, all these things are measured with the XDL series. A lot of people are already using this. We have the XDLM series, which is basically used more in the connector industry, where the sample sizes are quite small, or say fastener industries where you have M3 or lower fasteners. Even say spark plug industry is where these XDLM series instruments are seen. Now both the XDL and the XDLM series comes with a proportional counter detector. That's why you will see more of the applications are the simple applications and not thin coatings. These are coatings which are above 50 nanometers or 100 nanometers. Then there is a XAN 250, which comes with a silicon drift detector, which is mostly used for ROHS trace analysis or screening, which is the first step. So here we don't say that this is a final test of ROHS, but it is a screening method wherein you can at least screen your sample and say whether it is ROHS failed, ROHS passed, or if it is inconclusive, it can be sent for further analysis. So the only samples which are inconclusive needs to be sent for to the other external lab for further testing and evaluation. The XAN 250 also supports you with solution bath analysis and material analysis. The XDL and the XDLM series also helps you in solution analysis, but XAN 250 gives you, because it's a silicon drift detector, it gives you a very accurate measurement as far as material analysis or solution bath analysis is concerned. This can also be used for your NIP or electroless nickel plating as well, but on flat surfaces. You need to remember that the XAN 250 is basically a bottom source, wherein the X-ray is basically coming from the bottom, whereas the other instruments are basically top source, so the X-rays are coming from the top. So similarly, you have the XDL 237, which is now also coming with the SDD detector. This will actually, the another advantage here is basically it comes with the XY programming. So the XY programming actually helps you in doing multiple sample measurement and gives you a faster measurement time. So this is the main advantage. Plus, so the XAN 250 basically was a bottom source instrument, whereas the XDL 237 is basically a top source instrument. So there are advantages of measuring even on complex shape samples using the XDL 237. Now, in the recent future, we have also launched something which is called as a gun type XRF, ideally suited for plating thickness measurement on big samples. And one of the major application is basically zinc nickel or zinc plating, which is there in the market and on big components. And this gun type XRF actually helps in that. You can also do some amount of material composition analysis, plus you can also do bath analysis. Finally comes the XDV Micro. In this, you have a polycapillary tube. So what is basically the advantage with a polycapillary tube is you have a very high count rate, and it is basically also comes with a small spot size, as low as you can go up to say 20 microns or 10 microns. This is more used in the wafer industry or SMDs or solar cell applications where you need to measure thin films. So this is, and even analysis of silver or silver alloys, or say you have very thin coatings that are which are complex, or multi coatings which are complex in nature, can be measured using this particular instrument. You can also do material composition analysis, plus it's an automated system, so you can also do programming of the XY stage to measure multiple locations, which actually helps you in saving time as well. Other than that, we are also in a position to support you with reel to reel plating thickness measurement. So this in India not that prevalent at the moment. Here people are still comfortable using the desktop instruments, but a reel to reel plating instrument is basically measuring the plating thickness in line. So we have a provision in doing this, especially for the connector industries where you have different types of connectors which are reel to reel plated, and we have systems which can actually help you in that with a feedback loop to your process so as to control your process as well. The biggest advantage using this is basically you can have a feedback which is given at the time of plating itself to control your giveaway, and which will ultimately lead to profitability. You can contact us if you are interested in getting more details on this, because we can show you, also help you in determining how you can save you by using this particular technique. So that completes the EDXRF technique. Now we come to the coulometric method, which is basically a destructive test. So the coulometric method is a process of deplating of a metal coating from a metallic or a non-metallic base with constant electric current using an electrolyte. So there are two techniques used here. One is for single coating. So here you just deplete the metal, and once it reaches the base or the substrate, the instrument automatically stops and you get the value directly displayed onto your screen. Now, so how it does is, how it measures is basically based on the voltage jump which occurs when so what all are the components in this? You have a measurement cell. In the measurement cell you put the electrolyte, and then there is an electrode which is placed and a pump which starts depleting the surface or pumping the electrolyte. So initially the between the electrode and the base material a voltage is then applied. So depleting process of the coating starts, and when the coating is completely depleted, there will be a sudden voltage jump which will actually cause the instrument to stop and give you the accurate value for that coating. So this is mainly used for, say, chrome on nickel coatings, or say your piston rods, or say fasteners in many cases. Another one important function of this instrument, which is little different, is basically coulometric step method. Now this is basically used for your multi-layer plating thickness. So you have a nickel layer. In nickel layer itself you have multi-layers, that is bright nickel, semi-bright nickel, high sulfur nickel, or like that. So the coulometric step method actually helps in determining these different steps of nickel. And Fisher has an instrument which actually helps you in doing this. So you can see here how there is each voltage jump is calculated by the instrument, and we provide you a small step software which will actually let you know at what point there was a voltage jump and by how much amount, which actually helps you in determining at how much was the thickness of each of these individual layers. These are normally used for decorative coatings or say bath fittings, where a lot of chrome, nickel, on copper, on ABS applications are done. And it is very important to know how much is the different thickness of the nickel layers. This, in short, gives you a small idea as to how it looks, how the graph looks like, and at what point how the coating looks like. So this can be measured using the coulometric method. Now, finally, we come to the nano indentation method. So the nano indentation method is an instrumented indentation technique which helps you in determining the hardness properties of your coatings or material. So it is connected to a computer, and you get the values directly. So how the principle works is, there is a force which is applied, this force is applied in such a way that you can control the force by knowing how much. So we have ranges starting from 0 to 2000 millinewtons. So you can apply, depending on what is the thickness of the film, we apply the load. You can control it either by the thickness or you can control by the load, the measurement. So now what we do is, once the measurement of the load starts applying, the load is programmed in such a way that it should not penetrate more than 1/10 of the coating thickness. So if you say that your coating thickness is 10 microns, then the force applied should not increase or penetrate more than 1 micron, because if you penetrate more than 1 micron, then you are actually not measuring the hardness property of the coating, but you are actually getting influence from the substrate as well. Now, many of the people are still using conventional methods. So because of that, what happens is they need to do a very thick coating so as to eliminate the substrate effect or the surface base effect, what we call. So this is how the process starts. You have the instrument where the force and the thickness or the penetration depth is defined. And then you have an indentation which is done on the sample. So you have a loading curve and an unloading curve which is shown. And then comes the computer where you actually have the display of the value, or a programming can be done using the computer. The most important aspect as far as this is concerned is basically the zero point determination. So how accurately you determine the zero point helps you in determining how good the measurement is. So Fisher has automatic zero point calculation, which helps you in which selects the most appropriate algorithm and helps you in determining the zero position accurately. So what are the values that we measure? So we are basically measuring only three parameters. We measure the HM, that is the Martin's hardness. We measure the HIT, the indentation hardness. This HIT is then converted into HV, which is generally what customers want, by using a factor, which is shown here. And then we have the indentation modulus, EIT. So these are the three parameters which are generally, which are mostly calculated by the instrument. The others are calculated values. So this actually helps you in determining the properties of your coatings, the hardness of your coatings, the elastic properties of your coating. And so it's more... Most applications are basically in the paint industry, or say even for coatings of, say, hard coatings like PVD or CVD coatings, where it is very important to determine how much is the hardness value of the coating, so that to understand how long these coatings can withstand and what loads these coatings can withstand. So these are the product offerings from our side. We have a Pico Indenter, Pico Indenter Basic. So these are more for R&D and research purposes. You have a provision of even attaching an AFM to this to understand to have a better imaging of the indentation which is done. And then you have HM2000, which is more used for the paint industry to find the properties, physical properties and the hardness properties of the paint. And for bulk material or big samples where you just want to do a reference to know how much is the hardness value of the coatings which are done, you can use a HM2000. This doesn't mean that you can use this only for coating. You can also use these instruments for bulk at times. But coating evaluation of the coating properties is the major function of this instrument. So here you can see the advantages of the nano indentation and some of the most why it is more used. So sample size and shape is not user interface, so the device is easy to use after short introduction. So people, untrained people, can also be using the instrument after being trained. And it has been designed for harsh environments. Now I'll just run you through some of the applications or industry segments that we cater to for the paint and corrosion market. So you have shipbuilding, oil and gas, wind energy, chemical industry, paint industry, and rail coach. So these are the major industries for paint and corrosion that we cater to. Industrial, we have a more wider application areas. So you have automotive, solar, connectors, hard coatings, and all. So you can just see an overview of the different in an industry what all may be the main areas where coating thickness is important. So you have the paint shop, raw material, raw suppliers. So these are where plated components come from external sources. Then there are electroplating shops in where you do in-house plating. Then there are electronic parts which are coming from external suppliers as well as in-house. And then finally you have decorative and coating, hard coating parts which are there. So for the automotive quality inspection, you can see I have shown you some of the applications which are common. So you have zinc, nickel, galvanized sheets. Then there are electronic components with tin and nickel. Then there is ROHS trace analysis. There is decorative coatings which are important. Some solution analysis is also important. And hard coating, so for cutting tools or so PVD, TI and titanium nitrate for that. Even for watch industries, these titanium nitrate and PVD coatings are important. Checking of painting components, this is also an important application in automotive, and paint properties finally can be used using the anode indentation. So let us see some, I will just run through it. It's self-explanatory. We'll share this presentation with you all after the webinar is over. So you can go in detail as to what all are the different coatings for different industry that we can support. There are some special requirements as well. You can always get in touch with us and we'll be able to help you with that. We also have something called as an inspection plan, wherein we can define a plan and load it into our instrument, and which will guide the user as to where the measurements can be done. This is a main application for the paint industry, which can be utilized. Aerospace industry, as I said, is more from anodizing. Electrical conductivity measurement is one of the major applications for them, paint on aluminium, and then comes the connectors which are used for aerospace, which is also a very important application for them. Electronics and wafers, PCBs, ICs, lead frames, photovoltaics, all these things are covered with. So these are the major applications which are used in those industries, and we have instruments specially designed for these industries as well. PCBs, as I said, we have instruments for surface copper measurement, we have for tin measurement, then we also have for PTH holes. We also do some kind of automation for gold plating or gold on palladium nickel applications, which can be used with automation. And all our instruments are the SDD, especially are as per IPC 4552A, so it meets those criteria as well. Decorative hard coating, as I said, we have chrome on nickel on copper on ABS, which is one of the main applications. Even for step, we have a solution for that. Other than that, you have a gold titanium nitrate on SS or nickel on copper, zirconium nitrate, palladium nickel, all these things, which even DLC. ROHS trace analysis also can be done with this. Apart from this, we also provide solutions for as per Industry 4.0 or IoT. In case if people want to have link our systems with, say, your process industry in future, we will also be able to support you with that. So we can also connect it to PLCs and get information from our instruments directly to PLC to give you a process control as well. The new technology which you can expect from our side is basically for paint or plastics. This is, we have been getting a lot of requests for this particular thing. We are still in R&D phase at the moment because this is a difficult technology. So we are using something which is called as terahertz, which basically calculates the refractive index of each of these colors. So it is a difficult process. And we are at the moment in the process of creating standards for this particular application. Once it is done, we will be more than happy to share more information on this. And this will be the future that we look forward to. Now, just to give you a brief about the company. So we are basically Elman Fischer Group. We are based out of Sindelfingen, Germany. This is the manufacturing setup that we have. We are world leaders in supplying precise and innovative products for coating thickness, material analysis, material testing, and micro hardness or nano indentation, what we say. Our, as I said, our headquarters in Sindelfingen, Germany. We have 22 affiliated companies worldwide. We have 80 distributors which are there and resellers, representatives all across the globe, and with 500 plus employees worldwide. You can see our different subsidiaries worldwide with our offices. In India, we also have a small manufacturing unit, which we started last year. So to cater to our jewelry industry, which is also quite big for us. So we are basically ISO 9001, 2008, 2015 company. And we... worldwide, we are known for our service, which we can provide within 3 to 48 hours. This is what we want to live with and be known for. And so as I was showing you till now, the how we started from 1953, where we started with basic coating thickness gauges. Then we had the XRF which came in, and by 2000 we added the nano indentation, and now we are going more towards the inline applications so that we can propose support you with automation as well. In India, we are there all across India with regional offices in Delhi, Calcutta, Chennai, and Bangalore. We are now coming up with an office in Ahmedabad. Unfortunately, because of COVID, we have to delay that. But soon or later, once this is over, we will be opening that office. So we cater to our customers from all these locations. So, and we have resident engineers as well all across India. So why partner with Fisher? As we told you, we are basically a global company with local support. We have standards, traceability standards, which will help you in getting accurate measurements and reproducible results. We have national presence with sales and service support all across India. We once you have a Fisher product, the total cost of ownership is with us. So we can always support you whenever required. You have a security of the investment which is being done. Plus, we also have an application center in Pune, which can support you with different applications. So we have a lab there in case if customers require the samples to be tested. They are more welcome to send their samples to Pune and get it tested from us. So support from Fisher India post the COVID-19. We know this is hard times which is going on. And we would like to ensure you that once this is over, we will always there. We'll always be there with you. We will provide you all the technical support and services post this lockdown. We will be sending shortly some do's and don'ts to our XRF customer, XRF users, so that they can follow some precautions while switching on the instrument, because we understand some of the instruments will be off for more than 2 months. So it is important that you need to follow these steps before you start working on them again, so that we we don't face any issues. And we will also circulate a centralized helpline number which you can use to communicate with us post the lockdown. And we also have set up centralized as well as regional teams to support our customers after partial lockdown. So this will be some of the supports that we will be for supporting you. I thank you for your patience and the opportunity given to me. So we are there with you in this fight against COVID, and we are sure that we will overcome this. So stay safe, stay healthy, and take care. Thank you.